2017 Ford Focus. Found about one of those websites where you type in where you live, what type of car you're looking for, and the payment you're wanting. And then they tell you all the cars that are available in your area. So this particular vehicle was available at one of our local dealerships. It was the only one that they had on the lot. It actually took them about 20, 25 minutes to even find this thing once we brought in the paperwork from the website. It's black, four doors, small, and simple. It really has very few of the bells and whistles that most new cars nowadays have. And I like that. It's not fancy. And right now, I don't want fancy. Maybe later on down the road. But right now, I just need something that'll get me from point A to point B. And this car fits the bill. There is one thing, however, that I can't stand about this car. One thing that actually made me take it back to the dealership only a few days after I got it. And one thing that if it keeps happening, I'm gonna light this motherfucker up. In LA traffic, there's a lot of slow driving. A lot of times where you're just crawling along 5 miles an hour, inching your way towards a stop sign or a stoplight. And to me, that seems like that would be relatively easy on a car, right? I'm asking you, car, to take me about 5 miles an hour for maybe 30 minutes and not give me any fucking issues. Does that sound reasonable, car? Well, it sounds reasonable to me, but apparently for a 2017 Ford Focus, it is not. Because just a few days after I got this thing, and after spending about 30 minutes in traffic, crawling along at a snail's pace, a warning light comes up on my dash, and it says, your transmission is overheated. You need to pull over and wait for 5 minutes so that it can cool off. And I'm like, what the fuck is this? So I ignore it. And a couple minutes later, it pops back up again. Only this time it says, basically, we're shutting this shit down. Well, I'm in the middle of traffic, so there's no pulling over right now. There's only stop dead in your tracks. And so I sit there for 5 minutes, the longest 5 fucking minutes of my life, waiting for my transmission to cool. Finally it does. I start the car back up again, go back into traffic, and about 10 minutes later, here comes the warning again. Your transmission is overheating. Please take 5 minutes and let it cool off. Are you fucking kidding me? Now luckily this time I was close enough to my exit that I was able to turn and start driving back at normal speeds. But that whole situation just blows my mind. This car is able to drive at 70, 80 miles an hour for long periods of time, no problem. But ask it to drive 5 miles an hour for 30, 45 minutes, and this thing just falls apart. It does not like to go slow. It's not built, apparently, to go slow. In fact, it's built in such a way that if you go too slow for too long, it just shuts the whole damn thing. I had this post on Facebook come up the other day, and it was a video of my son from several years ago riding his scooter. And the video was him landing this trick where he goes off this ramp, spins the bottom of his scooter a couple times, and then sticks the landing. I think it's called a double tail whip. Now the video, while it's only a few seconds long, is awesome. He does the trick, sticks the landing, and looks at me like, did you see that shit? And he smiles. And what you don't see on the video, however, is everything that led up to that moment. This kid would practice for hours and hours doing the same trick over and over and over again. Now, I could see that with each attempt, he was getting better. I could see it. Him? Not so much. I remember a number of occasions where he would try the trick and fail. Just throw his scooter across the yard. He would try it, fail, say a few choice words under his breath. He would try it and fail so many times that I know sometimes to him it felt like he was actually getting worse as he practiced. Now what was happening was that he was progressing, but it just wasn't at the speed that he wanted. He would watch these guys online doing these ridiculous acrobatics on these scooters and get frustrated because he wasn't at the same level. Not understanding that many of these guys started doing this shit before he was even born. He was moving forward, but it was just taking so fucking long. And while it was never permanent, many times, like my car, he would just shut it down. I spent 3 days on one word. It took me 3 days to find just the right word to put in my script. I was writing this romantic comedy several years ago called The Arrangement. Basically about a guy from Chicago that calls into his local flower shop all the time ordering these arrangements for his girlfriend. And for the cards that go with these flowers, he recites these beautiful poems to the clerk at the flower shop over the phone. The clerk discovers that his girlfriend doesn't really appreciate him or his poems very much. And ultimately, she sets out to break them up so that she can have this guy for herself. Now, the script was a pretty fun one to write. Lots of funny characters and scenes. Took me a while to write, as they all do, but overall, I got this one done fairly quickly. There was, however, one particular part where I was simply trying to describe a reaction on the face of one of these main characters. And I was tired of using the same old adjectives and adverbs, so I was trying to come up with some clever way to present it. And I couldn't come up with one. For 3 days, I searched and searched for this word. I looked in a thesaurus that I had. I looked online. I even tried these sort of word association games to try and come up with something different in terms of the way I was describing just this look. And for 3 solid days, it felt like I accomplished absolutely nothing. There was literally no movement down the page. I finally did get it, and when I did, the feeling of relief was indescribable. But what a waste of time, right? I mean, 3 days on one word. 3 days, and I didn't accomplish shit. Or did I? Write it down. That was one of the first things I was told when I started working out. Write it all down. The reps, the sets, the weight, write it all down. Because then you can see how you're progressing, right? So when I first started working out, when I was back in high school, it's exactly what I did. I had this little notebook, and each time I worked out, I would write down 4 sets, 10 repetitions, 50 pounds, or whatever the numbers were. And I did that for a while. But after several months of just religiously writing down all of my numbers, every workout, I started to get a little discouraged. After several months, I was basically writing down pretty much the same numbers now, day after day. Now, for a while there, in the beginning, I was just blowing up. Felt like I was increasing both the weight and the reps almost every workout. But now, it sort of plateaued. I didn't like it. After a while, in fact, it honestly felt like I hadn't made any progress at all. Felt like I had just been wasting my time. But Then one day I flipped back to the beginning of that notebook. And I saw those numbers back when I first started. And those numbers were tiny compared to where I was now. I had made a lot of progress. It had just come in really, really small increments. So small, in fact, that I hadn't even realized how far I had really come. There's a passage in the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 3, and I think I've read part of this to you guys before. It says this. It says, what do workers gain from their toil or work? It says, I've seen the burden God has laid on the human race. He has made everything beautiful in its time. He has also set eternity in the human heart. Yet no one can fathom what God has done from beginning to end. I know that there's nothing better, it says, for people than to be happy and to do good while they live, that each of them may eat and drink and find satisfaction in all their toil. This is the gift of God. The Bible says that God has made everything beautiful in its time. It says that no one can fathom what he has done from beginning to end. It says there's nothing better than for people to be happy and find satisfaction in their work. But that is a gift from God Himself. Sometimes it feels like you're getting nowhere. Like you're working and working and working and just not seeing results. Or it's just not happening fast enough. It feels like slow is the best you can do. And sometimes you just want to shut it all down. Stop trying. Stop wanting. Stop dreaming. And start rationalizing. Getting practical. Settling. Your body is not growing the way you want it to. You just can't find the right words to express, maybe on paper, how you feel. You can't land that trick or that girl or that job that you want. You've tried a million times. The transmission goes out in your car because you're just not going fast enough. But things are happening. You may not be able to see them, but things are happening. And what's happening is simply this. If you're not growing externally, if things aren't happening for you externally, then things are happening on the inside, internally. You see, that's the process. In order for you to be ready for what's coming externally, you have to be prepared internally. So the bigger your dreams, the longer it's going to take. Because if you're not prepared internally for what you're receiving externally, you're ultimately gonna fail. Now my Ford Focus may not like it, and it may try to shut me down. But sometimes I need to go slow. And you do too. I sincerely believe if we work hard, we'll all get exactly what we want. I believe that. But I also believe that in the meantime, we should, as Solomon suggests, eat, drink, and find satisfaction in all our work. And that if we're able to do that, if we're able to enjoy both the destination and the journey, the payoff and the pain, that is a gift from God. Glasses up to good friends, great nights, stiff drinks, real conversations. I'll see you next time.